Thank you. All right. Hopefully you all can see my screen. All right. So thanks everyone for having us today. We're very excited to share our work with you and get your feedback. This is still very much a work in progress, so we appreciate any thoughts and suggestions that you have at the end of this talk. So to begin, I want to briefly walk you through the motivation for this research. I first became interested in neoclassicism while in my first upper level music seminar as an undergrad. As an intrepid pianist and math major, I decided to analyze one of the more complicated pieces we were studying that semester, Igor Stravinsky's Concerto for Piano and Wind Instruments, which he wrote in 1924. I sat down with my trusty pencils and tried to figure out what was going on with the tools that I had, which were based on identifying types of chords we typically find in music that is tonal, which is to say that it's in a key like C major. To my surprise, this technique didn't work at all. Stravinsky's music sounded tonal to me, but it just wasn't working like any tonal music I'd previously encountered. He would use chords that weren't supposed to follow one another, and some things that weren't chords at all. For that presentation, I eventually gave up and talked about the history of the piece and its overall strangeness, but that experience never really left my mind. In retrospect, my confusion made some sense. From the 1920s until the early 1950s, Stravinsky's musical writing often explicitly invoked the genteel, emotionally bounded French or Italian styles from the 18th century that I was used to analyzing in my music theory classes. But he also shrouded all of those references in some kind of ironic distance. It was both tonal and not, familiar and strange, a number of dichotomies applied. We'll listen now to the first opening measures of the piano concerto that fascinated me so that you can get a sense of what I was experiencing. Just a quick taste. So the opening here contains several references to 18th century classical styles and even earlier. The uneven rhythms recall a style of opera overture popular in France in the 17th century, and the underlying harmonic progression is almost typical. With a little recomposing, we can understand it fully as a traditional opening gesture in the key of A minor. So I'm gonna play these examples for you side by side so you can get a little bit of a better sense of what I was hearing that was different. So here's the Stravinsky version played on the piano. And it's particularly the chord in measure two, this kind of crunch that Stravinsky introduces that isn't typical of an opening gesture in a key of A minor. So if I make a few changes, just alter the pitches up or down a step, I can get to something quite a bit more common. But though they're similar, the pitches that Stravinsky uses here are important. Those crunchy pitches that he adds neutralize the ability of this opening to establish a clear key center, to give us that sense we have a home. And these changes then, these notes, make the introduction feel a little bit more unpredictable, a little more unstable, and a little bit more unfamiliar than we might expect. And the instability in this piece has an interesting backstory. Stravinsky wrote it for himself to perform with orchestras, but he had a lot of trouble remembering it. He forgot the second movement multiple times, once when he was writing it and it burned accidentally. And then when he performed it for the first time, he played the first movement fine, then took a little break. And when he wanted to start the second movement, he couldn't remember how it began at all. The conductor had to sing the opening gesture for him. And it's possible that we can put this all down to stage fright, but it's also possible that Stravinsky did something in this music that made it difficult even for himself to remember, that broke even his own ability to expect what would happen next. And this resonates a little bit with my own experience, which is that despite having studied this piece for many years, it took me a really long time to be able to play it from memory or to even hum it. And that's not something any musician really likes to admit, that we can't remember or memorize our music. But it was a really interesting experience. And so I shared this with Stravinsky, and I wanted to know, were other people experiencing Stravinsky's neoclassical music like this? So I began to dig into historical documents to find out. I went to archives, I trawled the internet, I searched out letters, fan mail, reviews, anything that would contain traces of an audience member's reactions to this music at its premieres. At first, I explored these materials through close reading. I found that I was counting adjectives and categorizing them, but to know how often people expressed particular reactions to music and what this could tell me about what it was like to be there then. While I know that written words cannot fully capture these experiences, the texts that listeners leave behind do act as written traces. And analyzing these materials begins to open a small window into past moments. I find these windows useful because they point me toward a very different way of analyzing music than some of my colleagues have explored. While many present-day music analysts are interested in understanding Stravinsky's neoclassicism either as an outgrowth of the same compositional styles he employed in his Russian ballets like Rite of Spring, or as something that can be understood as something that's tonal but follows just a few different rules, I find that the words that people were using to describe their contemporary experiences show something that's a little bit messier and a little bit more interesting. They're often interested in hearing Stravinsky's conflicting impulses simultaneously and hearing those to different degrees and in different ways in different performances. So to better understand where these responses start, I'm going to shift my attention now to a slightly earlier work that's sometimes considered Stravinsky's first neoclassical foray, a ballet called Pulcinella. The ballet centers on Neapolitan commedia dell'arte puppet Pulcinella and his exploits. And Stravinsky and his collaborators included a lot of different 18th century elements in the set design and the music. You can see an illustration on the slide of one of Pablo Picasso's costumes for the ballet. And Stravinsky took on the role of music arranger. He updated a number of works that he thought were by the 18th century composer Giovanni Pergolesi. It turns out we now know that these were a wide variety of people, most of whom were 18th century Italian composers, but actually only one piece in this entire ballet is by Pergolesi. But Stravinsky didn't know that and neither did his reviewers. So while the alterations that Stravinsky made to the music he received were minimal, the result of his changes were striking. Many listeners described these changes as utterly Stravinskian, and Stravinsky himself seems to have felt this similar relationship. He later described this work as both a backwards look that was also a look in the mirror. Not only was this music consciously looking at the past, but it was using it to reflect something about the present. And the juxtaposition seems to have been the point of the piece. And that's where tartar sauce comes in. The French writer Henri Prunier reviewed the 1920 premiere saying, quote, "Finally, the diabolical Pulcinella with music by Pergolesi and tartar sauce added by Stravinsky." I was intrigued by the metaphor and its implications. Quite aside from the somewhat disparaging Slavic reference, the idea that in Pulcinella, Stravinsky slathers 18th century music with a condiment, changing its flavor and perhaps trying to make it more appealing, suggests that music analysts wanting to recover a similar experience should focus on how Stravinsky's additions change the flavor of the music. So here's a quick comparison of Stravinsky's overture and the original that he altered. This was written by Domenico Gallo, another one of those 18th century Italian composers. And from this sort of analysis, which is inspired by the idea of layering, it's easy to see where Stravinsky's tartar sauce resides. It's in the musical interior, and you can see this on the right-hand side of the slide in the diamond-shaped note heads. You can see that they're all in the middle of the score. Everything that's in the outer voices, the black numbers and the white numbers, is the same from the Gallo. There are also other changes that Stravinsky makes, most notably to instrumentation, and later on he adds and deletes some measures from different scores, but a lot of the tartar sauce you can hear in this example. And so we'll listen to the Domenico Gallo version first and then the Stravinsky to hear that relationship. Here's Gallo. And then here's Stravinsky's version of the same measures. So I hope you can hear even a little bit that sense of difference there of what we might be hearing as tartar sauce, those inner voices that are changed. They get quite strident in the second half of that phrase where we start to see dyads, these layering of two notes that are quite close together to give us a little bit more of that sense of stridence. And there's a lot to analyze here in terms of just that idea of tartar sauce, which I do elsewhere in my work. But I also wanted to know, how well did Prunier's feeling match what other reviewers felt? Was this a distinctly French feeling? What about people who weren't musically trained? What about later reviewers or writers about other pieces of music? Does the tartar sauce metaphor extend more broadly? I had a corpus of these documents ready and waiting, and I started to learn about digital techniques for dealing with them. So first I dealt with things manually, searching my Excel spreadsheet for instances of words beginning with a prefix I wanted and counting them up, or by using ready-made tools like Voyant tools, which is a great first foray. I have a few illustrations here of that work to show you how things were going. As a side note, all of the text analyses going forward only include English language sources to avoid issues of translation, but this is something that we're working on and would love input on from the DH community, how to ethically compare sources in different languages. So my first attempt was with word clouds with heavily edited stop words lists. I've highlighted some of the words in red that I found useful for understanding the corpus that I had of documents from 1920 to 1950. And there's an interesting set of words here. There's an overall proliferation of positively valenced adjectives. There's a focus on rhythm, of melody. There's a focus on different composer references. And there's a relatively small interest in Stravinsky's Russianness, which did show me that perhaps the emphasis on Russianness in present day analyses doesn't quite match what contemporary people seem to be experiencing and at least reflecting in their written traces. This next slide compares a subset of reviews for very early 1920s responses to Pulcinella and the Piano Concerto. Again, we can see some interesting things. Each cloud contains a referent composer quite prominently, Pergolesi for Pulcinella and Bach, who seems to have been the referent composer for the Piano Concerto. And there's some interesting emphasis on old versus new in the Pulcinella cloud. But there's also some obvious and well-documented issues with word clouds and the ability to heavily edit the stop words list, which is the list that you give this word cloud so that it'll ignore things like the or and, but also Stravinsky or any other word that I choose to have it ignore. And it provides all of this content out of context. I don't know whether any of these words are preceded by the word not, like it could be that all of this is not good, or it's not Pergolesi. And so this wasn't a very good way for me to figure out what was going on in these sources. So I turned to another Voyant tool, which is Collocates, where I could get a little bit of a better sense of prominent words and their relationships to one another. And these are two of those graphs. The left-hand side is the graph for Pulcinella, right-hand side for the Piano Concerto. And I was able to use the word clouds to guide more detailed searches, focusing on words that I wanted to know more about and see how they related to one another. Those lines show us the relationships between the words, how commonly they're linked. And so I learned a little bit. I honed in on the right-hand side on two words I was especially interested in, how the Piano Concerto relates to the idea of the composer Bach and the idea of counterpoint. And these graphs did tell me a good deal about both pieces. We see on the left-hand side that the relationship between Stravinsky and Pergolesi is heavily connected by the word altered, which I found quite useful and has interesting implications for analysis, but it still left several things to be desired. So on my own, I was making some good progress, but I felt like my results were neither as helpful nor as significant as I would have liked, in part due to the small size of my corpus, but also because I found myself relying a lot on things like adding stop words until I made a graph that I found analytically interesting. And I also needed to make multiple different graphs in Voyant in order to do any kind of comparative analysis. And so that's where my work with Europe's at MIT comes in. I was fortunate enough to have two Europe's work with me in the summer of 2020 to help expand and code my corpus so we could do more detailed comparative analyses that would run in Python. One of my Europe's, Nina, is here today to show us some of the excellent work that she did during the summer and to walk you through some of those results. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Nina and then I'll come back to conclude the talk. So Nina, whenever you're ready.
Yes, I'm ready. Okay. So hi everyone, I'm Nina Goodman and my role in Xerox was primarily building the tools to analyze the text in our corpus and to visualize our collected data. shown as a brief dependencies chart on each function I wrote to parse, count, sort, compare, and analyze words and text. Today, I will use a corpus containing documents written about Stravinsky's Apollo to showcase some of the higher level functions as indicated in red. And the outputs from these functions are usually used in visualization, of which today I will showcase the sentiment graph. Next slide, please. And so this is a sentiment graph on the Apollo corpus, and there are about 20 documents in here right now. And the graph is equally scaled on both axes and starts at zero. So the line y equals x divides the graph into two as to separate texts that are more negative in tone to those that are more positive. We calculated the overall sentiment for each document using the Vader sentiment analysis tool. And one of the questions we sought to answer last summer was whether or not the tool is an accurate measure for tone when handling documents in bulk. We can answer this question by using our tools to further analyze the text, of which I will focus on the more extreme and isolated points we see on the graph here. Here are the sentiment scores for the five documents in question. Vader is more sensitive than the default one provided by the NLTK package because it is able to discern degrees of enthusiasm in words and in punctuation. Individual scores of lines within the text are scaled and aggregated to produce a compound score between negative one, very negative, and one, very positive. A compound score between negative 0.5 and positive 0.5 is considered to be inconclusive. Next slide. To supplement the Vader sentiment analysis tool, we developed a targeted way of assessing sentiment with our word distroRoot function. The goal of the function is to return only the words used as descriptions of the performance or piece in question. The intuition is that I am more likely to find descriptors located adjacent to the words that represent the subject, which I call target words. These words are listed here and are user defined. Then I choose a window, which is an integer specifying how many words adjacent to the target word on each side to consider. We usually stick to five because the chances of a word being a descriptor gets smaller as the window gets larger. Lastly, I return only adjectives, nouns, verbs, and adverbs found within the window. And a notable feature is that words with the same root as the target words are considered to. For example, when I indicate that the word play should be targeted, plays and played will be considered also. I applied this tool on each of the five documents I've circled on the previous graph. Document A was determined to have the most negative tone. It's located all the way on the bottom right. The first line here is a result of the sentiment analysis. And the second line is what is returned from invoking the function word distroRoot. And immediately we can see some negative terms such as disappointing and unhappy. The third line is the sentence in the original document that utilizes these terms. We can see that this audience member definitely disliked a 1929 performance of Apollo, and our findings affirm the result of the sentiment analysis. Document B is one of the most positive in tone, lying all the way in the upper left. Utilizing the function word distroRoot yielded little because the text itself was short, but we can see here that our findings again affirm the results of the sentiment analysis, as this concert goer enjoyed the orchestral qualities of the piece, which contrasts starkly with the previous review and how they evaluated Apollo's classical style. Next slide. Document C is located close to the line y equals x, but the high negative score of this review indicates that it should be more closely reviewed using targeted text analysis. We can see that like document A, this review compares Lully style to Apollo. Here, the comparison is made by using the term wrong, which is probably the reason for the high negative score, but Messiaen uses a term more in an observation of Stravinsky's neoclassical style, his works often being called wrong note music, than as a derogatory remark. Document D is also relatively close to the center line, but it has a highly negative compound score. Like others, this review focuses on the technical aspects of the piece, so the sentiment analysis seems to be correct to consider this review as more neutral than not. Next slide. Document E is a letter written by Stravinsky himself, and it has an interesting position on the graph because it is isolated from other points that lie above the line y equals x. Analyzing the text using the function word distroRoot reveals an unexpected and rather strong negative sentiment towards the way Apollo had been performed. This review highlights the faithfulness with which Stravinsky expects his pieces to be performed, and we can contrast the usage of the term wrong used in document C written by Messiaen and this document by Stravinsky. While Messiaen uses the word wrong as a description of Stravinsky's style, Stravinsky uses wrong to condemn Ansermet's actions. To sum, an initial observation of data using sentiment analysis, followed by targeted text analysis using the function word distroot, ensures a comprehensive look at the data. With more data, we can expect to track sentiment across years or across different works as well. Even with a relatively small corpus of 20 documents, our current tools offer data that gives us close insight to the varying sentiment towards Apollo across the years. One auxiliary function is word count by field, which can be used to gauge which words might be commonly used across documents or even across different works. Here we can see sample invocations using the word love and beauty for the corpus Apollo, and words of the same root of the input are also searched for. We see that the function caught two more variants of love and beauty, and we can see the corresponding text documents listed here. This time, I search which pieces have the term dissonance most mentioned in their corresponding documents. The method will look for matches with dissonance, dissonances, and dissonant in all documents of our entire corpus and return the number of matches for each piece. From here, I might take interest in the Rite of Spring and Pulcinella, which had the most number of hits. I can make subcorpuses on documents pertaining to just those two works and use the function word count by field again, but this time to find in which document we can see instances of the target word, and the results are shown here. Next slide. Okay. So I began this Europe last summer having absolutely zero background in digital humanities, and there was a steep learning curve for me. It was my first time working collaboratively on a major project, let alone in a new field. But the opportunity has deeply instilled in me the importance of research, perseverance, and patience that things were going to work out. And I would hardly say our work is finished. Our future tasks definitely include spot checking as outlined here. I would optimize a process that tags words to their parts of speech, as a built-in mechanism provided by the NLTK package does tend to be error prone. By using multiple parts of speech tags to ensure no important words are omitted, though we have been bypassing this problem. Our corpus is still small, and despite the power of our tools at hand to analyze small corpora, we must work on completing our metadata and building a library large enough to perform more generalized analyses. And I would love to review our current methods and revise them to increase efficiency, which will really matter as our corpus gets larger. Lastly, although we weren't able to tackle this task much during the summer, the ultimate goal is to develop a user-friendly interface such that the process of analyzing bulk text is streamlined. And thank you so much. That's all for me.
Thanks so much, Nina. I really appreciate it. And it's been great to get to work with you. So as you can see, and as Nina has excellently outlined, this corpus still needs to grow a lot, and we still have plenty of work to do. But we have grown quite a bit in our analysis. So to close up the talk, I'd like to show a little bit about how these results affect my music analyses and why that's valuable for me in what I work on in music theory. So I'm going to show you a couple of other graphs that Nina made for me. So here are some graphs that compare the top words used in Pulcinella and the piano concerto corpora. Nina, you have your hand raised?
I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to raise it. It happens to me sometimes. I'm so sorry.
That's
please
okay.
Please ignore that.
That's all right. Okay, so here's a graph comparing the top words used in Pulcinella and the piano concerto corpora, separated by parts of speech. So these graphs do have some of the same issues that we have with word clouds in that they don't give us context about text, but they do make it a whole lot easier to see trends. And so we can deduce some useful information even with a simple tool like this. Our nouns graphic highlights some important features, one of which acts as a control for us. We see that pergolesi is more often associated with Pulcinella, while Bach is most often associated with the piano concerto, which is what we expect to see. We can also learn some useful information from the common adjectives list. The concerto receives the word new slightly more often than Pulcinella, but receives the word modern quite a bit more. We can't tell from this graph whether that's a positive or a negative word, but modernism was often associated with this new sense for the concerto, and it's something that we want to explore more in future analyses. One of the most interesting parts of this graph for me is the word little, which is often associated with Pulcinella. And so a next step for us is developing a function that we call word windows, where we look at larger sentences that surround words and see what's within about 5 words of a target word. And so we want to better understand what this word is doing and what it means to talk about Pulcinella and use this word little to describe it. Next, we have the most common verbs associated with each piece. And one term that stands out for me is the word danced. My intuition would be to associate this word more with Pulcinella because it is a ballet and the concerto has never been choreographed. But here we can see that that intuition doesn't play out, at least not in the corpus that I've gathered. And so one thing I can do in my analyses are try to pull out what might have been dance-like about the concerto that might have brought this to the forefront for people. It's certainly not a way of experiencing the music that is ready to hand for me. And so the analytical process in this way can bring out an experience that is antithetical to mine and hopefully help me hear that better, help me perform a piece differently if that's my goal, and bring some of that to the forefront. I'm still working on exactly how to musically analyze this particular verb, but I will show you an excerpt from the concerto that I think might be some of the impetus for this. So we'll look briefly at this and then go back to that graph. So this is an excerpt from just after that introduction that I played for you. This is rehearsal number 5. This is when the piano and the orchestra get going in full force. And Stravinsky is evoking a Bach toccata here. So there's a lot going on in both hands. For the most part, we see that it's going on in 2-4, though every once in a while we do change our time signatures. And one thing that Stravinsky does quite often is he takes musical gestures that we call ostinatos that repeat over and over, but he offsets them so that they don't actually have the same length. So we have on the top line in the right hand, something that is repeating every 12 eighth notes. And then in the left hand, something that's repeating every 10 eighth notes. So the circled material is going to start over before the right hand is finished with its gesture. And so we get this sort of offset feel that I think might contribute to this sense of something a little bit dance-like, but also quite Stravinskian in its kind of oddities. So we'll just listen to this quickly. That stopped before I meant for it to, but it continues in this way where we have this sort of offset and moves into a little bit even more march-like character. But that's an interesting adjective that we want to explore more in the future and see again with those word windows feature, what exactly are people trying to say about this feeling danced? Returning to that most common verbs list, the last thing that I want to point out on here is the number of verbs that are associated with some kind of a relationship. So we don't see anything specifically here about tartar sauce, which you wouldn't necessarily expect to, but we do see a reference to leading, following, and influence here. And those are all words that mean that we're thinking about some kind of a relationship. And this supports that notion that I had back with the Premier's text that understanding Stravinsky's relationship to his reference is important, but it also complicates it by showing that the way in which his reference experience can vary by reviewer work and performance. So to conclude, I just want to end with one final example of, to explore these relationships musically, old and new, Pergolesi and Bach versus Stravinsky, leading and following. And to do this, there are 2 tools that I found useful for these analyses. The first is recomposition, which I've already shown you. And the second is understanding Stravinsky's writing as deviations from common tonal patterns, which we call schemata. Each of these tools allows for Stravinsky's music and its reference to remain clear, but highlights the relationship between them in such ways that I can explore these ideas of relationships, whether that's leading or following or tartar sauce. So our last musical example here is again from the opening of the first movement of the piano concerto, a few measures later than where we ended in the introduction. And this is a passage that has kind of continued to elude me. It's something that's quite tricky to figure out. Stravinsky introduces something here that feels like Bach. It feels like it's a chain of falling material that feels like it has the sense of just kind of descent in a way where we almost expect where it's going to go, but never quite exactly correctly. It just doesn't quite work no matter what I do. And so there's a number of possible patterns referenced here. And so we'll listen and I'll highlight those on the score as we listen. And the slide starts a little bit after where the music example starts. So I'll have a big arrow when the music example starts. So what I've highlighted here are three possible ways of understanding this series of notes. So the first is a primer, which is a type of musical schema that I'll show you on my next slide. Descending fifths is a type of musical sequence where we move around what we call the circle of fifths, basically to chords that are a perfect fifth away from one another. And then also this idea of a converging cadence, which is often associated with a primer, which is another schema that just approaches a chord by kind of converging on it stepwise. So here is a more idealized version of a primer to a converging cadence. This is in the key of C minor. And then we might expect it to resolve here. And so that does a decent job of modeling what Stravinsky might be up to, in the sense that we can hear some of those relationships, we hear those outer voices being present, we have some of those moments of convergence, but it's not an exact match. It's not as easy to figure out as the Pulcinella example, where you can kind of see where these things are coming from. So the next thing that I do is take those types of schemas and try to recompose them into the musical fabric. Try to do something that's closer to what Stravinsky actually had in mind, but using either the primer or the circle of fifths sequence to try to kind of approach that a little bit differently. And I will play these for you, but I will preface this with they don't sound great because I am trying to do something that is a little bit speculative. So there are moments where it's gonna sound very much like the Stravinsky version that you just heard, moments where it's going to sound a little bit more like that idealized version, and moments where it just doesn't work at all. And that's kind of the point here. So here's the example where I've recomposed things mostly as if we're dealing with primers and converging cadences. I feel like that one works for the first line or so, and then it really just goes off the rails and it doesn't sound like Stravinsky or like anything at all. So then I also have my falling fifth sequence version. And so this one. Has moments that lock in at different points. And so I feel like together we start to approximate something that feels a little bit more like what Stravinsky was going for, but with a few more of those references pulled out. And I am not by any means advocating for either of these recompositions over Stravinsky. His version is certainly better. But the point here is that there's some way in which all of these things apply all at once. There's something very visceral here where we can hear patterns and expect where they might go. They generally fall. There's a push and a pull between things that happen in the music that might give rise to that idea of leading and following. There are dissonances that follow the consonants, but nothing ever quite works as we imagine. So it seems to me that Stravinsky is referencing all of these tonal possibilities at once, and I wouldn't have thought to do this kind of analysis, except for having done this kind of textual analysis that we've explored here, which taught me to look at this music from a more kaleidoscopic view, searching out Stravinsky's tartar sauce and his references as layered and diverse. The text analysis in the end allows us to dig deeper into possible experiences and reanimate them through music analysis and performance for present day listeners. Thank you.
That's wonderful. Thank you both so very much. We really appreciate it. And I feel that there are so many musicians and musicologists and professors of music history that I would like to open it up to questions from the audience.
Stephanie?
Yeah, I'll break the ice here and ask a question. And I'd say if you have questions, you can either sort of put them in the chat or raise your hands and we'll give a call on you. Thank you so much. That was so wonderful to see. And Nina, thank you so much for your work. It was great to see your analysis. And it's clear that you've really helped Sarah kind of thinking through some of these things and thinking into some new problems there, as you were just saying at the end. I was wondering, you guys both sort of talked in different ways about how maybe affect is part of how you approach music. Nina, you mentioned kind of surprise. And Sarah, you talked a little bit about, also about the sort of mental health and perhaps this was part of Erica's introduction to you. So I was just wondering sort of, affect I think of, and this sort of sentimental analysis I think of as being this kind of property of texts. And I am obviously coming at this as like a literature professor and thinking through your use of these textual analysis tools. So can you just say about how that kind of translates between text and music for someone who's not an expert in the music side of things?
Yeah. And Nina, jump in if you feel like you'd like to take this as well. I think there's certainly not like a one-to-one relationship between something that is written in a text and an experience that someone has with a musical idea. But certainly, as you mentioned, like surprise and expectation are a huge part of music. And so one thing that we talk about a lot in especially music cognition is thinking about the ways in which writing a piece can either confirm those expectations, and that often has an affective component in that you are very, maybe pleasantly surprised that something goes where it goes. And you might have that sort of positive feeling, or you might find that to be boring if it goes exactly where you expect. You might have a positive feeling if it goes somewhere that you don't expect. We talk about this a lot with a type of cadence that we call a deceptive cadence that takes us to a different area of the key than we expect to go to, and that can feel very positive. But in terms of, I think I may be kind of misunderstanding your question, but in terms of just like, if there is an affect that is mentioned in the music and we have that sort of, or in the text, and we're trying to figure out how that appears in the music, it's often, it's difficult and it's tricky because, words and feelings are not always mappable, and then trying to use words to describe things that you hear in a piece of music can be incredibly difficult.
It would be really interesting to see if you could do, sorry to interrupt, but if you could do some sort of kind of parallel analysis on the musical text itself. Maybe Mike Cuthbert can help you with this and see if there's any way to sort of map those relationships, and particularly, you have this small corpus. How do you use the small corpus to your advantage? Well, it could be a way to have a concentrated parallel investigation. Anyway, it's really interesting. And about surprise, I was surprised that it sounded like the music surprised Stravinsky himself. He forgets it. It's a great anecdote. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Stephanie. I think Marty Marks was next.
I have a question.
Ellen, do you want to go first? Marty's waving you off.
Oh, all right. I was interested in that you suddenly turned to partimenti in the schemata in the printer, and I was curious, first of all, how often one can sort of see that as an underlying feature of Stravinsky in general, and has anyone discussed that? And what we know about Stravinsky's musical education. I mean, was he actually learning with these schemata?
Yeah, so first of all, with the schemas, it really depends on the piece, how audible they are. Certainly in Pulcinella, it's really easy. And so I've done some of that work. And there's a grad student at WashU, Dan Biggers, who has also done some work on Partimento in specifically Pulcinella. But especially in some of the, especially the 1920s works, I think it gets harder in the 30s. But looking at Apollo, looking at parts of the concerto, looking at also Rake's Progress, you can find those schemas quite often. And certainly certain ones are easier than others. So he uses a lot of Romanescas, he uses a lot of printers, he uses several of the ascending and descending sequence schemas as well. But we do know that Stravinsky was trained in a slightly similar way, or at least we have assumptions that he was. So he studied with Rimsky-Korsakov as a younger student, and Robert Yerdian wrote an article back, I guess in 2011 now it might've been, about this circle surrounding Rimsky-Korsakov sending around basically Partimento realizations that they were playing as a game. And it is mentioned in that article that Rimsky-Korsakov was also sending these to his students. So we have reason to believe, at least, that Stravinsky was trained in similar, though not, you know, not as Italianate. There's certainly a lot more sevenths and ninths in those chords than we might expect.
Right. Well, I mean, that's fascinating. I mean, with Pulcinella, you would expect to find it because there's the 18th century bass underneath it. So, but if you're finding it in Rake's Progress and in other neoclassical works that don't have a distinctive 18th century, what shall we say, base, I suppose. That's really fascinating. And I didn't know about his education or the play with this that he did with Rimsky-Korsakov. So that's intriguing to me.
Yeah. Well, it's an article I'm working on, but is not done yet.
As most articles are, not done, right?
Marty? Hello, Marty, can you?
Yeah. Sorry, I put it up and I forgot to bring it back down. Thank you, Sarah, very much. It's so clear to me, just as a comment, how immersed you are in the concerto, which has got to be one of the thorniest nuts by Stravinsky to crack. And I'm fascinated by that, but more generally, I was fascinated by one very small thing, and then I want to raise a larger thing, two small and large. Mm-hmm. Small is, and that one of those graphs, it looked like, if I read it correctly, the word original was applied more frequently to Pulcinella than to the piano concerto, which I found very paradoxical, but I was trying to understand that, and I wondered if it caught your eye.
I had a paragraph about that I cut for time, but my sense from just looking back at the documents is that they're talking about Pergolesi's original music, okay. And that's so Stravinsky's alterations of the Pergolesi original, and that's where like a word windows function would help us see that maybe Pergolesi is always right before the word original, and that
so would... This just reminds me of the motto of Howard's End by Forster, which is only connect, which is the idea of context is all. And I am a little bit unclear how you get context pulled back in to these modes of analysis without just going back to the text itself. Whereas it seems the whole purpose of this kind of graphical or numerographical analysis is to find an abstracter way that isn't as dependent on a reader and what a reader pulls out. It's more dependent on what patterns can be found. Whereas, and I'm wondering what your goal is with that byplay, you know, or that oscillation in motion. What do you hope to realize through this kind of methodology?
Well, I think what I'm looking for and hoping to find eventually, that we're still working on the tools and the corpus define are the types of larger phrases that commonly persist around particular pieces. So not just the word original, but that they're talking about Pergolesi's original in a specific way for Pulcinella, and that we don't see that in another piece. And so I'm very interested in comparisons, trying to understand how an experience is different for one piece versus another, and trying to understand how those things change either with different pieces or over different times or with different types of reviewers. So one thing that I am hoping to explore, if I can ever figure out the language issue, is I've noticed some differences between reviewers writing in England versus the US at the same time. And I'd love to know if those differences also persist between the UK and France and those sorts of things. Are there specific types of phrases that people only apply to Stravinsky's music or only apply if you're using a particular language? Like maybe people only use food metaphors if they're French. I don't know, but that's something that I'd like to know. And then, you know, for me, it's always about turning that back to the music and trying to understand what would that mean to hear it this way and see if I can have a new hearing or a new experience from doing that.
Thank you. Helena, would you like to go ahead?
Thank you. Marty, you stole half of my question, so half of it has been answered. Thank you. my question was also based on this linguistic thing, but I wanted to say this is a great paper. What an interesting research project, and thank you for illuminating all these wonderful chords. And maybe Nina has something to say about this as well. With the linguistic component, my interest in this is also based on if I could use this tool on my research, because I'm selfish, and taking these word problems that I find in Latin in my texts that I have, and you know, I have translations that I work with as well, but I mean, I'm assuming that most of these English words that you were projecting were from translations, that these original texts are in French, or if they are in English, they are, you just said, either from the UK or for America. And so my interest is also, for me, we always try to identify the dates of these texts from the Middle Ages. And it's really hard for us to tell because it's not our mother tongue, it wasn't their mother tongue, and we have a lot of discrepancy. So I think that we can find something really interesting about how people describe music in the 20s, 1920s, as much as the 1220s. But what are some methodologies that you have behind the scenes dealing with these different linguistic nuances in different contexts, like Marty was trying to suggest? Like, is this something that is possible, or do we still need this human historical knowledge to help support this idea?
That is a great question. Nina, do you have anything you wanted to mention on that?
Yeah, it came up while preparing for this presentation, actually. The word wrong that I was mentioning during my portion of the presentation, the way it is used differently from Messiaen versus Stravinsky. I believe the Stravinsky document was actually a letter written in English, but Messiaen's was a French translation. And without Professor Eicher's help, I would have just trusted what the program spit out at me. That wrong was used twice within the Apollo corpus, and I would have interpreted them the same way, but Professor Eicher pointed out the nuance within that word. And it's hard to think that the word wrong would have a nuance to it. But to answer your question, I only resolved this problem with, you know, that human part in me telling me that there had to be a nuance, and there wasn't anything with the program that was differentiating that, so.
Yeah, and perhaps the DH folks can step in here and tell us if we're missing something completely obvious. But I think that that's been an issue for us as well with words like movement. Like, does it mean the movement of a piece, like just a single portion, or does it mean, because these are ballets, movement? And so that's been difficult to find. And so for the most part, I've been ignoring those words if I can't figure out what they mean. But that's not a super helpful response. Sorry, Alina.
Thank you.
No, it was very helpful. And I think it's a useful tool. I mean, it's like I create these kind of word clouds as well, and I don't find like I'm getting anywhere either. So I think there's a lot of room to move forward in this type of work with text.
I mean, I think that's one place where looking or like for context might be helpful, and seeing if you can at least spit out, most commonly this word appears surrounded by these words, you know, or X word, it all often appears very close to this word, and that might help. At least then you're doing the human work of interpreting it, but on a slightly more distant scale. So you're maybe looking at the tens and twenties of works instead of just one. Mike?
Thanks for really, really great paper, Sarah and Nina. Great to meet you. A little comment on what I heard from Marty first, if you don't mind. If we have to go back in and look what original means, or what movement means, you know, what's the point of doing this? I really do think though that these tools give us an opportunity to see what we do want to double check. And, you know, it's one of these things why we need the computer to give us 20 or 30 things that look fascinating, because 18 to 25 of them are going to be false leads, but at least, there's the ability to jump in and look back, especially if you have a tool that lets you look at the context of every mention of the word movement, and to find out, okay, that's movement three, that's movement two, oh, that's a dance movement, oh, this is a movement toward modernism or a movement backward, something. And so I think that those, in the DH lab, we found that really valuable in looking at the gender novels project, of looking at where these gender words come in and how do they pop out. There's sort of a question / suggestion or possibility for Sarah and Nina on the work. This is a small corpus, but it's a difficult corpus to expand quickly, so I understand that. One of the things that I've found helpful when I have a small corpus is to be able to start looking at ways that the members of the corpus can talk to each other pairwise, so that you look at this pair of documents and this pair of documents. Because if you have 20 things in your corpus, that's, you know, that's not that much, but you have 400 pairs, or actually 200 pairs of documents. So it's a way of, if you're trying to see for every document, what does every other document say about the things that this document is most concerned with? It can just be a way to go up, or looking at the core of well-edited, well-selected documents compared to, you know, just a mishmash search and a web search on similar terms, and, you know, how they work. And so that leads finally to an actual question. Have you thought about doing a cross temporal comparison between what these early sort of at the time things said, and how for every one of those words, do they appear more often, less often, you know, over time? What are the words that are disappearing, and what are the words that have come in and to replace them?
Yeah, I have. It's a really interesting thought, and it's one that I haven't explored very much yet, but it's certainly something that's very interesting. It would be it's not something I've thought about recently, but certainly in kind of thinking about how things have changed about how people talk about this music over time, and even, you know, people think a century isn't that long, but a lot can change. There's a lot in there. So thank you for that suggestion. Nina, did you have something you wanted to add to that?
Yes, I was gonna say that very elementary, but it got cut from the presentation. But in preparing for the presentation, I actually compared that Stravinsky letter that I mentioned with another document, with every other document actually. And I mapped the number of common words. And I found that the Stravinsky letter and one of Harold Box's documents had about 20 words in common, while others had 3 or 4. So I looked into it, and then I found that the two letters were actually responses to each other. And the common words were very unique. They were like coda, answer me, and ignored. So I definitely did start looking into that idea of pairs, and I think that is a very good way to continue the research. Yeah, for sure. Thank you.
And the other thing that we've thought about but haven't started doing is comparing different reviewers, thinking about people who write about different works over the course of their lifetime. And we have some reviewers who are very highly musically trained, and we are actually fortunate to have some documents by people who have very little music training but wrote a lot about their musical experiences. And so one thing we'd love to see is comparing those and see what kinds of words come out if you are a musically trained listener versus not. Though again, those corpora are quite small. Oh, Erica, sorry.
Oh, no, please go ahead. No, I was, please go ahead.
Charles? You are muted.
Charles, you're muted.
I'm thinking it would be really interesting if you could continue with the idea of incorporating some Stravinsky texts into your corpus. I mean, I could imagine it would be really fruitful to compare, you know, the words that were coming up like in the Poetics of Music with what audiences and critics are responding to. Are they hearing the same thing? Have they read Stravinsky and they've decided to describe what they're hearing in his terms, or, you know, how that's influencing each other? So I think that would be a really interesting thing to add to your thinking as well.
I like that a lot. One thing that I have done with that is I have found that Stravinsky is actually the follower in most cases with those things. That especially like Boris de Slojer and some of those reviewers are writing, and then that those words show up in his next documents. But it would be interesting to trace that a little bit further and see how that continues and
well, which direction they feed. And there's sort of the issue of who's actually writing Stravinsky's writings, even from the 20s, is complicated.
Mm-hmm. Roland Manuel, anyone? You
know. Yeah.
Just a bit.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Nina. I mean, I have questions, but I think we are at time. So unless others have further questions, please join me in a round of applause for our wonderful presenters. Thank you both so very much.
Thank you for having us.
All right.
Thank you guys so much. It was great. It was a great presentation. Great to have you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us. Nina, I wanted to ask you actually, the very small question I had is, you mentioned surprise. Stephanie had already said this, so I didn't want to sort of belabor the point. But I wondered either what you were most surprised by or what the shape of surprise looks like for you. Like when you want to track surprise, what might that be for you, do you think?
Oh, so this Europe definitely changed how I looked at surprise. But when I mentioned surprise, my bio is, it's a personal project I'm working on quantifying surprise. And the method is twofold. One would be to quantify the acoustical parts. So I utilize, you know, principles of just intonation to see which chords are more consonant than others and was more expected. And overtones, that would also be an acoustical component. But now what I realize is there's also a non-acoustical component that I should be thinking about, which is, as we talked about in this presentation, the idea of expectation and intuition when listening to music. And that is a big one that can't really be easily mathematically translated, but if I can find a way to do that, that'll be a very good ticker for predicting surprise in classical music. And I think one way I could go about doing that is, as Professor Eicher did, she recomposed some of Stravinsky's music to make it sound as how we would expect it versus how it actually is. And then if I could, right now what I can do is I can put chords into a program and it'll spit out a bunch of numbers at me from 0 to 10, and which maps how consonant, which would be closer to 0 versus how dissonant, closer to 10 it would be. And if I had an original and a recomposition and mapped those and saw the differences in harmonic progression, then I can see, you know, I could track surprise ideally mathematically. So that's how I'm thinking of surprise right now. And now I'm thinking I could even add this digital humanities component to it, where I could collect a bunch of texts written about a certain work and then use that also to help me as a ticker to help me determine if people thought it was surprising or not. Yeah.
Yeah, sort of thinking about the qualitative aspect of composing a corpus, right? Which is, yeah, which are the ones that are likely to indicate in a certain way, which is not what we usually mean when we are talking about corpus analysis, right? But I think it's a really fascinating question in this context. Thank you. Thank you both so much.
Yeah, thank you. Wonderful. And Erica, thanks for asking that question. It was a great answer from you, Nina. I'm glad to have heard it.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Ken and Ryan, do you have any advice on directions, further directions for the text corpus project, since you're in the room?
I have a comment possibly on further directions for the surprise project.
I did too. Okay. Yes.
Sorry, so just because we were talking about that most recently, but the other thing you could look at is just like take an n-gram approach to this, right? Mm-hmm. Look at not just harmonic progressions, but just look at like pairwise harmonic progressions. So look at like bigrams, basically. Like, you know, what is the, if you're say looking at a tonal corpus, you want to see like, you know, after you see a 5-7 chord, how often do we see one versus six versus something completely random, and use that to sort of weight your surprise measures. It'd be an interesting approach.
I did a little bit of Googling around to see what kind of music generation with Markov models is out there, because I could imagine a thing where you're using some kind of a Markov chain to generate like the 10 most likely next chords after a certain bigram, and then determining whether the chord that actually shows up fits into that, and using that as a rough proxy for surprise, which could be kind of interesting. Not something that I know a whole ton about, so I didn't want to say too much about it, but it seems like a cool possible avenue.
I would love to get there, yes, thank you.
And with Markov models, I have a couple of things, Nina, that I can send you. I have a colleague who did a dissertation on this kind of generation that I'll send you.
That would be absolutely amazing. Thank you so much. That's where I want to be.
Great. Well, super. Thanks so much, everyone. Great seeing you. And hope you all survive the snow. It stopped snowing here, at least. But
Thank you.